Praise the Lord. Why don't we lift up our hands and just worship our great Savior? Amen. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, God. This morning has been rich. Hands are untied. And then we have just heard some very, very practical teaching for effective church. I believe in organization. I'm not just talking about ministerial organization. But you know what? I thank God for the growth of the Wisconsin district. Aren't you glad for the growth of your churches? And I know that God gave this district a vision, and it gave it a plan of fulfilling that vision. And every department started putting it into action. We all were going for the same goal. And you know what? God never fails. Amen. He just continues to bless and to add such as should be saved. Brother Hook, thank you so much for that good message this morning on Hands Untied 2017. Amen. Brother Hook's had me come to his church several times, but he's had me preach. I told him when he got back, I said, that is the best message I have ever heard you preach. That is the only message I've ever heard him preach. But that was very, very good and very timely. Last night, Brother Harpo was speaking on present. I don't know about you. More than enjoying the message, I thank God for the unbelievable thread that goes through every conference and every midwinter camp that I've ever been a part of. And it's amazing when you consider people are coming from different areas, but there is one God, there's one head of the church. Amen. And that is Jesus Christ. So today, in this session, I would like to go a little bit in a different direction, but not very far. Because we've heard about being present in the church house. We've heard about there's nothing wrong with the seed. There's nothing wrong with God's hands, but it's untying ours. And today, I want to talk about all of us. Brother Harpo just asked you a question. How many want to be used for God? Huh? How many want to be used for God? All right. I want to show you how. And I think this is one area that we have grossly underestimated in the kingdom of God. So I address your attention today to the Gospel of John. This is chapter 4, and also the 10th chapter of Romans. And I do thank God for our revival commission. I thank God for Brother Hook's leadership. I thank God for Brother Indris, our Section 1 Revival Commission representative, all the great work that he has done. And I just thank God for the wonderful crowd that we had last night. Thank God for seeing all of you this morning, that you're present. And I just thank God for what he's going to yet do tonight, in the service tonight with Brother Harpo speaking. John chapter 4 and verse 35, it says, "Say not ye, there are yet 4 months." You know, we're very good about, it's always about tomorrow. We have a great revival coming. I've been in the church now 45 years, and I have heard that every year that I've been in the church. Folks, we need to open our eyes and recognize there is a great revival happening right now. Amen. Say not ye there are yet 4 months, and then cometh harvest. Behold, take account of. I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already. Everybody say already. Say it again. Say it to your neighbors. They're already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice. Everybody say rejoice. Together. Whoever is sowing and whoever is reaping together. Everybody say together. We rejoice in what God does. And herein is that saying true. One soweth and another reapeth. Jesus said, I sent you to reap that whereon ye bestowed no labor, other than labored, and ye are entered into their labors. Romans chapter 10. Paul writes to the Roman church and said, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet. And that word beautiful is really timely. How timely are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Today in your hearing, I want to speak to you today about calling all the messengers. Calling all the messengers. Would you put your Bibles down and would you lift up your hands? And would you just simply ask God to speak to your spirit and your heart? Hallelujah. Father, I do thank you. I thank you for your great church. I thank you for the privilege of being a part of it. I thank you, God, for this district. I thank you, God, for every saint of God, every minister, every pastor, every evangelist. I thank God that you, dear Lord God, know what we have need of. And I pray, God, for your touch, your anointing, and dear Lord God, with that confidence, dear Lord God, to share what saith the word of the Lord to the church. In the power of the name of Jesus Christ, we ask these things. And everybody said, in Jesus' name. Everybody said, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now clap your hands and lift up your voices. Why don't you shout a little bit of the goodness and the glory and the majesty of Almighty God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and say, God's calling you. God is calling you. Now turn to your other neighbor and say the same thing. God is calling you. Amen. You may be seated. Penny Lee is an author. And she wrote of an interview that she had had with an elderly German man who lived through the Germany's darkest hour, and that was during Adolf Hitler's dictatorship. I don't think we have to give a history lesson today to realize what took place there prior to World War II and during World War II in the land of Germany. And blaming all of Germany's woes on the Jews And then, of course, building such a case that they decided to eliminate the Jews through what we know in history and what we have seen with our own eyes and through film clips, amen, of what's called the Holocaust. But this elderly German man that she was interviewing, he recollected to her and said, "I lived in Germany during the Nazi Holocaust, and I considered myself a Christian. I've attended church since I was a small boy. We had heard the stories of what was happening to the Jews, but like most people today in this country, we tried to distance ourselves from the reality of what was really taking place. What could anyone do to stop it? A railroad track ran behind our small church, and each Sunday morning we would hear the whistle from a distance and then the clacking of wheels moving over the track. We became disturbed when on one Sunday we noticed cries coming from the train as it passed by. We grimly realized that the train was carrying Jews. They were like cattle in those train cars. And week after week, that train whistle would blow. We would dread to hear the sound of those old wheels because we knew that the Jews would begin to cry out to us as they passed our church. It was so terribly disturbing," he said. "And we could do nothing to help these people, these poor, miserable people, yet their screams tormented us. We knew exactly at what time that whistle would blow, and we decided that the only way to keep from being so disturbed by their cries was to start singing our hymns. So by the time the train came rumbling past the churchyard, we were singing at the top of our lungs. If some of the screams reached our ears, we would just try to sing a little louder until we could hear them no more. Years have passed and no one talks about it anymore. But that elderly gentleman said, but I still hear that train whistle in my sleep. I can still hear them crying out for help. God forgive all of us," he said, "who called ourselves Christians, yet did nothing to intervene." Brothers and sisters, it may not be a literal train whistle that we are hearing, but I don't believe that any of us can deny what we are witnessing all around us of the dire devastation and destruction of what sin has unleashed across our nation and our world. There are so many people all around us that are in bondage spiritually, mentally, and even physically, aimlessly being led like cattle to the slaughterhouse, headed to an eternal damnation without hope and without purpose. I personally desire, and I too want to see America become great again. But I realize, church, that America's greatness is not found in our economical well-being. America's greatness is in recognizing and serving our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. America needs a spiritual awakening. Do you hear me? America needs a spiritual awakening. Wisconsin needs a spiritual awakening. A heart-transforming revival. We need the kingdom of God and his powerful salvation to sweep our nation. Brothers and sisters of Wisconsin, our district is being challenged by God's word through his spirit. We are literally being called according to God's word. We are literally commanded to be a church of action. And using a naval term, it is time, church, for all hands on deck. That was something that is said when everyone's help. Everybody say everyone. Everybody say everyone. Everyone's help is needed, especially to do a lot of work in a short amount of time. Church, I thank God for the message I heard last night. We need to be in the house of God every time that we can be in the house of God. The word of God says, forsaking not the assembling of ourselves as the manner of some is. But church, amen, we can no longer excuse ourselves by hiding out in our sanctuaries. Nor can we aimlessly and purposely just go through the motions of mere religious calisthenics while our neighborhoods and our schools and our workplaces and our nation as a whole are falling apart. I hope you just understood what I said. Falling further and further into an amoral abyss of hedonism and debauchery. Church, our Lord and Savior has already given his church his commission of what we need to do. We need to go. There are no boundaries or limits to where and who we are to reach. Jesus himself said it best, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you, 2017, amen, in these next few years, this is our hour. This is our day. This is our very purpose. You and I have been brought to the kingdom for such a time as this. I don't care what our age is. I don't care what our gender is. I don't care what our status, social status in life is. God is calling his church to go. He's calling all the messengers to go forth taking action. Simply speaking, a messenger is a person who carries a message. And what a message we have to share. I said, what a message we have to share. What a message we have to share. I'm telling you, this message is not getting old to me, brother. I may be 45 years in this, but I'm telling you, the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ is still the thing that will unleash, amen, and change this world. God's word tells us, in Psalms, it says, making his messengers, amen, the winds, his ministers, a flaming fire. Brothers and sisters, it is more than just a good feeling that we have inside of our beings. But like the prophet Jeremiah said, his word was in mine heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones. We who are born again of water and of spirit are his present day messengers. God is calling all his messengers, not just card-carrying individuals with the United Pentecostal Church International, but all that confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord of their lives. The Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy, his son in the gospel, he says, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world. This is God's purpose. This was why Christ came to the world. Amen. To save sinners, of whom Paul says, I am chief. Howbeit, for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern. Everybody say a pattern. And is there anybody in here that's glad that you're a part of the body of Jesus Christ? Is there anybody in here that is truly thankful for the baptism of the Holy Ghost and has been baptized in Jesus' name? Are you still cognizant of that fact in your life? And it is a pattern for not just me, myself, and I, but it's a pattern for everybody outside these walls and outside our church house in our given cities. Church soul business has always been the business of the church. We are to go forth and make disciples. Oh, Brother Putnam, don't you have anything that you go, just get me excited so I can dance a little bit? My friend, I'm talking to you with all of my heart about the purpose of why we are even here. He went, look at the example that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ set before us. He went forth reaching out to all. Everybody say all. No matter what their pedigree or culture, he invited them to follow him. He invited mere fishermen to follow him, and they did. He approached a social outcast, a tax collector of all things, to follow him, and Matthew did. Jesus stepped to the side of a funeral procession and touched the casket that was being borne for burial. And Jesus said to a dead young man, arise, and the young man arose. Amen. He said to the woman who was caught in the very act of adultery, he showed mercy and said, go and sin no more. To the impotent man at the pool of Siloam, he told him to rise and walk and take up his bed and walk. And he did. Multitudes were fed by him as fish and bread multiplied in his very hands, and they were filled. I'm telling you, church, Jesus, our example, took action. He went where people were. And he made the difference in their lives. He felt compelled to go through Samaria, a people who were half Jew, half Gentile. They were not socially accepted by either side. And there he engaged in a heartfelt conversation with a woman at Jacob's well, who in turn, amen, told her whole village, but say her whole village, come and see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? And many of those Samaritans came to see him. I ask you this morning, has Jesus Christ made a difference in your life? If he has, then you need to stand to your feet one more time. You need to clap your hands. You need to raise your hands and thank God for that difference that he has made in your life. Amen. If you're born again here today, you may be seated. Sorry to disappoint all of you that thought I was done. Then you have a story to tell. Do you hear me? You have a story to tell. A testimony. of what he has done for each of you. What this world needs is Jesus. I saw the video where our own brother Stone King spoke to the General Assembly of the United Nations, not intimidated. And he ended his words with, to that world body, he said, I give you Jesus. And what did he share with that world body? His testimony. His story of God's miraculous power in raising him from the dead. Brothers and sisters, the gospel message is very simple. It is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. According to the scriptures, this is the message, and it has to be delivered to as many as possibly we can. It must be delivered out of a heart of love. I have seen too many people that claim to be so holy, and yet they're arguing with people about, indeed, amen, over issues in the Bible. Oh yes, there's things that we hold very, very dear, and we know that they're truth. But my friend, you just arguing with someone is not going to get them or your benefit of reaching the lost. Had a man in our church in Monroe. He was an alcoholic. Bless God, he got sent to jail one night by knocking the tooth out of the guy next to him in the bar stool, arguing over by he should be baptized in Jesus' name. He was witnessing. Church. Apostle John wrote in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 10, he said, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him. It's on the screen. Read it with me. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. And by what, church? And by the word of what? Their testimony. And they loved not their lives unto the death. Church, what I'm trying to say today is we have got to get up out of our pews and get out into the mainstream of our social surroundings. We need to befriend people, sinner and saint. And we must be willing to pull down walls of social prejudice and go through the open doors that God makes available to each of us. Amen. Do you realize that the Apostle Peter had to extend himself, going past his own prejudice, as he dared to pass through the door of a Gentile's home, but he obeyed. Everybody say he obeyed the heavenly vision and the leadership of God's Spirit. And in that one action of obedience, God opened the door of salvation to the entire Gentile world. Brothers and sisters, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. What I'm saying, church, is we're spending too much time just talking to each other. Is that or is that not the truth? When was the last time that you shared your testimony with an unbeliever? The most powerful thing. You say, well, Brother Putman, I don't know all the Bible. You don't have to know all the Bible to share what God did for you. Well, I don't understand all that about teaching Bible studies. You don't have to teach Bible studies to tell people what God did for you. It is the most powerful tool that we have. And yet the church is satisfied with keeping our story quiet. I really believe, church, with all my heart, God wants to use you and I. You raised your hands and said, I want to be used of God. Well, my friend, I'm telling you, this is how you can be used of God. And he wants to do so on a consistent basis. Jesus will make the way. Turn to your neighbor and say, Jesus will open the door. If we will but willingly and obediently do his bidding. The Lord's very first public miracle was at a wedding reception. We know the event. The host had ran out of wine to drink. And our Lord's mother, Mary, went to the servants and said, speaking of Jesus, she said, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And those servants obeyed what Jesus told them to do, and they poured out the water, and it was made wine. Church, our Lord's directive is not complicated. This is not rocket science. We just need to do what he tells us to do. Thank you, Brother Hook. Psalm 126 says, they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. Our duty starts with a genuine burden for people. You're making me nervous, church. It starts with a burden for people. I thank God for people, Brother Stevens, Sister Stevens, that are willing, amen, to go out into the highways and the byways, amen, and start new daughter works like in Algoma that is now an operating church, amen, and thank God for Jesse Arcan that is overseeing that right now. But I tell you, it's also a new Holstein, and it came from two rivers. My friend, I thank you for Brother Soto, amen, for daring to leave ATC and go into Hortonville and now establish work in Hortonville, and to every one of us, that's just them. No, my friend, it all started with somebody willing to go out and to take some action. Duty starts with a burden for people, and that burden will resonate in and through our devoted prayer life. Not occasional prayer life. Burden enough to cry out to God for his mercy upon those we are praying for. Like the desperate prayer of Abraham for the righteous to be spared from the sudden destruction in Sodom. And then the psalmist tells us, he that goeth forth and weepeth, our action is required. We must be in tune with the Spirit, for when the door of opportunity opens, we then realize that the answer to our prayers, while we are bearing precious seed. And Brother Hook, you're right, there's nothing wrong with the seed. Is in sharing the greatness of God and his ability to do anything that is needful. Share your testimony, church. Turn to your neighbor and say, share your testimony. Share it as a word of faith. And I guarantee you that out of the abundance of your heart, the mouth will speak. But what we need to do is to get up and go forth taking action. Just this past August, Sister Putnam and I were so honored to be asked to do a marriage seminar in the Tabernacle of Joy in Singapore, pastored by a wonderful couple of Timothy and Leah Lee. And they're coming to our district, amen, in March, amen. But while we were there, we just got in there the night before really late. And the next morning, we were in the hotel, amen, Brother Harpo. We were in the hotel at breakfast. And I don't know what your custom is, but for Joanne and I, amen, our custom before we eat, we hold hands and we pray. Now, I guarantee you, we don't shout in the restaurant, "Oh God!" No, that's not it. We just bow our heads, but we don't be real. We don't try to whisper it either. We say, "Lord, just bless the food." Now, how many people pray before they eat? Huh? Do you realize even what you do is part of your testimony? We weren't halfway through our breakfast, and all of a sudden, a young lady that was sitting just a table over from us, amen, she came over to our table, and she said, "I couldn't help but notice," she spoke very good English, she said, "I couldn't help but notice, amen, that you and your wife prayed over your meal." She said, "I'm a believer too." And she went on to say that her name was Hazel, and she was there in Singapore from Bombay, India, amen, to learn from her bank in India, amen, to go through 3 months of training there in Singapore. And then she looked at me and she said, "I'm a believer." She says, "My uncle is my pastor in Bombay." And she says, "Can you tell me, is there any church you could recommend for me while I'm here to go to?" Well, let me think. Are you kidding me? I said, "Ma'am, we're here to go to a church to do a marriage retreat. And this Sunday, we're going to be preaching at that church. We'll be honored to have you come." Sure enough, she didn't waste any time getting a hold of Brother Lee. Amen. She was there that first Sunday. Amen. She was there, and you know, she didn't look like us. Amen. She didn't dress like us. She had on a lot of stuff that we wouldn't have on as our women. Amen. But you know what? She came. Amen. And all of a sudden, she was speaking in tongues. She already had the Holy Ghost. Amen. Bless God. Amen. And she was there. And I remember seeing her come to the altar and bow down, and just tears flowing down her face. Bless God. Amen. She was there for 3 months. Brother Lee kept on emailing me and saying, "Hazel's doing great. Hazel's doing great. Hazel's doing great." Amen. But then all of a sudden I get this video. Hazel's being baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of her sins. And she doesn't look like the Hazel that I used to see. And she goes back to Bombay. She shares her new revelation of the mighty God in Christ with her uncle pastor there in Bombay. And now the report has come back that he has baptized his whole church in Jesus' name. Because of testimony. Brother Harpo, we were present at the right time. So, well, that only happens to people like you, Brother Bud. Well, I tell you, people like me is no different than like people like you. Do you realize that God is not the least bit impressed that I carry a title called district superintendent? He's not impressed. He just wants us to be his children and to share our testimony. Our testimony. I'm telling you, you can be doing a whole lot of stuff. In your daily routines, just be always open. I just got my hair cut yesterday. looks not too bad. And first time, I just been going to this barber now for about 4 months. But yesterday, hey man, I started talking to him. I said, hey, we're having a conference up in Green Bay. Amen, starting tonight. And I said, amen, I said, we're going to have a great preacher up there. I said, and one of our speakers, he couldn't come. And I said, but what a testimony he's got. Amen, he was raised from the dead. And the barber quit clipping on me. I don't know if he was going for his razor in my throat or what, but he quit cutting on me. And I told him about Brother Stone King's testimony. Amen. Then I told him about my mother. Amen. That had a tumor in her breast that God miraculously healed. And by that time, he's just looking at himself and me in the mirror. And he said, thank you, Pastor, for those stories. I'm telling you, folks, you know where we get our greatest disappointment? Because we spend time after time inviting people to church. We spend time after time trying indeed to get people in the doors, and that's good, but we get frustrated when they don't come. But when you give your testimony, amen, there's nowhere for them to run. There's nowhere for them to hide. Bless God, they're either going to ingest it, and that's going to build faith and a curiosity in their spirit, because who can denounce your own story? My son, he went on a hunting trip back in early October in Missouri, northern Missouri, shot an 11-point buck. And so he couldn't go hunting that night because he had already killed a deer that day. Some other man from Pennsylvania was there in the lobby, and he had shot a deer. He couldn't go hunting, and they just started talking. Man said to my son, what do you do? He said, I'm a pastor. He said, oh, really? Of what type of church? He said, I'm Pastor United Pentecostal Church. And the man said, I don't think I've ever heard of them. Boy, wasn't that a blow. And that should be to all every one of us. He said, I don't think I've ever heard of that. He said, my son started clarifying. He said, well, he said, we came out of the Assembly of God several years ago because we do not believe in the Trinity. We do believe in the oneness of God. He said, well, praise God. He said, I never believed in that Trinity stuff. It never made any sense to me. He said, my brother is an Assembly of God missionary. He said, well, I go to a community Baptist church. He says, there's one thing my brother, amen, did share with me, and that's this thing about receiving the Holy Spirit. He said, I prayed for it, and I've earnestly prayed for it, but I don't think God wants me to have, amen, that Holy Spirit. John David said, oh, Brian, no, Brian. He says, God has promised you that experience. He said, would you like for me to go and pray for you, amen, to receive it? He said, you mean to tell me you'd come to my room and pray for me right now, amen, to receive this experience? And John said, oh, yes, I would. He went down to his room. John David told me, he said, Dad, he said, it wasn't 3 minutes, and he was speaking in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave the utterance. John David said to him, said, Brian, you also need to be baptized. Amen, in Jesus' name. And he said, well, Pastor, he said, there's a pond right behind this lodge. Mind you, this is 45 degree weather. It is dark outside. And he says, and John David says, let's go. They positioned the truck with the lights on the water, and he went down in the name of Jesus Christ. My friend, all you got to do is open your mouth. Brother Hook, you and I, we certainly remember the trip to Washington. Oh, yes. And we got canceled on our flight. Folks, can I tell you, that when things just don't go our way doesn't mean that God's not in it. Quit blaming the devil for everything. The devil would only love to think he caused as much credit as we give to him. They put us on the next flight the next day. Had to fly then to Philadelphia. I've shared this story many times. And then we went to Milwaukee. And on that plane going to Milwaukee from Philadelphia, I'm sitting behind some lady. And she said, boy, these airlines don't work like they used to. And I thought, aha, there's my chance. And I started telling her about the story about us getting our plane canceled. Amen. And so forth. And she said, these airlines need prayer just like I do. That was just like throwing raw meat to an alligator. I said, ma'am, I'm a minister. Can I help you? And then she started opening up with tears coming down. We're on an airplane. We're now pushing back from the gate. Amen. We're now taxiing out to the runway. And by the time we're getting ready to pray, we're going down the runway. And if you've ever flown, you know the centrifugal force that pushes you back against a seat. And I'm trying to bring this whole bunch of weight to that crack in the middle of those two seats. And the more I pray for her, the more she is breaking down. And lo and behold, amen, she told me that her husband was unfaithful to her and was in the act again of amen of adultery the second time, and she didn't know what to do. And she told me she lived in Vancouver, amen, in Canada and British Columbia. And I'm thinking, why is she going to Milwaukee? And I said, why are you going to Milwaukee, man? She said, well, we have another second home just north of Milwaukee in a little town called Kohler. That just happens to abut Sheboygan Falls, where my son pastors, and I was preaching there that next day. I said, Nan, you see that big guy on up the aisle? I said, that's my son, he pastors there. In Sheboygan Falls. I said, but I'm preaching there tomorrow, Nan, and Nan, I would be so honored if you showed up. And sure enough, 10 minutes after the 10 o'clock hour, here came Nan Gorecki with her life seemingly in shambles, amen, walking into a Pentecostal church for the very first time. And the whole thought was her family was coming up to see her because they were afraid that she might commit suicide. Don't tell me, folks, that the people that we rub shoulders with on a daily basis, that God is dealing with hearts and dealing with lives that none of us know anything about. But the matter is, God will place us and we'll be present at the right place at the right time if we'll just open our mouths. Stand with me today. Oh, I could go on and tell you about Pete Mays and people on airplanes. I said, Brother Putman, did they all come to church? I don't know. See, that's where we think we're all the failure. But folks, we got to understand, we enter into other men's labors and other people enter into our labors. And God, who sees the really big picture, we can't allow ourselves to keep our mouths shut just because we've had a few disappointments in people responding to what we've asked them. Church, I want to admonish you. Wisconsin is ripe for revival. I've had such a burden now for 3 years. If I get myself right in this building, the north, these northern counties up there, Do you believe that God wants us to have a witness in every county in this state? Well, thank you that a few of you do. But that's my fear, church, that we're getting so comfortable in our own little cocoons. And oh yes, we're getting blessed and we're thanking God for our blessings. But that is not exactly all the purpose of why we were saved. I've heard people say, well, Brother Putnam, there's not very many people up there. How many of them, of those few people that are up there, are not important to Jesus Christ? Am I glad that my cousin shared with me her testimony of receiving an experience where she spoke in another language that she had not studied? Yes. Are you glad that somebody shared with you their testimony? Every head bowed and every eye closed. Jesus, speak to us, God. Who knows? With your head bowed and your eye closed, Jesus could be speaking to a couple or a man or a woman in this service right now. Speaking to you about preparing yourself to be just the vessel that he desires to use. To be the witness in one of those northern counties. He could be speaking to one of you good pastors right now that is burdened and has been sowing in tears that out of your assembly a new preaching point could be birthed. Folks, Jesus is in this place. And there is no question where his heart is. There's no question about his purpose. I believe he just wants his body as a whole to go forth and to take action, being led by his spirit and obeying what he is saying. I wonder this morning, is God speaking to you? Oh, it may not be about the northern counties. It could be about your neighborhood. It might be about your workplace. It may be about your schoolhouse, your campus. It's people, people, people. Can you hear the call? Can you hear the call? Or will you just try to sing louder? To drown out his cause and his purpose in your life. Jesus said, say not, there are yet 4 months, and then cometh the harvest. I say unto thee, lift up thine eyes and look on the harvest. The harvest is already white. It's already ready. I open this altar here in the closing of this morning session today for those. You all incriminated yourselves at the beginning of the message. Jesus, I want to be used of you. Now I want you to come and mean business with God. Say, God, it's been a long time since I've shared my testimony. But God, I want you to help me, Lord. I want you to help me, God, to share. Hallelujah, God. My testimony, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Lord, let me open my mouth. The things that I do as simply as praying over meals. By how I look and what I do and where I go. Let me leave a very, very positive and compelling testimony, God, of love and purpose. God is calling all the messengers. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. Everyone needs compassion.
Love that's never failing.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, God.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Yes, God.
And everyone needs forgiveness.
Oh, yes, Jesus. God, open the doors, God. God, even yet today at lunch. In between, God. That we don't have to force the issue. God, open the door and help us to walk through it, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Yes, Jesus. Yes, God. Lord, saturate this whole state with witnesses, God. Witnesses of your goodness. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, yes, you can, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. You.
Forever.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus.
He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior.
Hallelujah.
The
hallelujah.
My God is mighty.
Oh, yes, Jesus.
He is mighty to save.
Hallelujah. Now pray for somebody else. Pray for somebody else. How about this? Go to somebody you don't know. That'll help you outside these doors.
So take me as
hallelujah.
So
hallelujah, Jesus.
And hallelujah. My life
oh, yes, God. Hallelujah.
I give my life to Father. Everything I believe in, now I surrender. I surrender, Savior. He can move the mountains. My God.
worship the Lord right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for the move of your spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Come on, church, let's worship God right now. Let's give him the glory that he deserves. Hallelujah. Oh, blessed be your name, Lord. Blessed be your name, Almighty God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We have truly been blessed today. Brother Hook, what a tremendous message. We got to get our hands out and start doing the work of God. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. We need to have great church. God bless Brother Harpo. By the way, if you filled out a card, pastors, if you filled a card out, you need to get with Brother Harpo right now and hand him that card before you leave today. And Brother Putnam, awesome. Let us never allow that train whistle to be drowned out. Let us always have a burden for the lost of this world. But I really feel that what was spoken last night set the precedence for tonight. Brother Harper wasn't supposed to be speaking to us last night. Or was he? I don't believe there's any coincidence. And I believe what he spoke to us last night about being present was for tonight. Because you know what? We've been blessed up to this point. But you know what? If you don't get what God really wants throughout the whole conference, if you miss the service tonight, if you're not present here tonight, I believe that there's something that God is going to impart to us in this service tonight that you're going to want to be a part of. Maybe you were thinking about heading home and going on and not coming back, and God's going to change your mind. God got a call in your life. Brother Putnam has said God is calling messengers. Maybe a call of God's going to go on your life tonight. This last year, we had tongues and interpretation in our church. God used me to do the interpretation, and I've never felt the anointing and the passion of God like I did that night. And literally when the tongues got over, I didn't have to wait. I didn't have to tarry. I already heard the voice of God. And you know what he said? He said, the end is not yet. We need to seek more. We need to do more. We need to desire more. We need to work harder. We need to work while it is yet day, for the night cometh when no man can work. And with this conference, the end is not yet. And the work of God is still to be done. Would you come out with us tonight? Come for 6:30 prayer. Service starts at 6:30. Not 7, 6:30. Come on out for prayer. The anointing of God is going to be in this house tonight. And we're going to let this world know, and we're going to let the devil know, that we're in the business of seeking and saving the lost. Hallelujah. Would you just lift your hands one time, one more time in dismissal today? God, I'm asking your blessing to be upon each and every one of us. Bring us back here tonight. The end is not yet. We still want to hear your voice. We still want to be commissioned by you. We still want to go into this world. Lord, I know that you've got a message for us here. Lord, lead us and guide us into the future. Your kingdom come, your will be done. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Would you put your hands together? God bless you in Jesus' name. Come on back tonight. Come for prayer at 6:30. We're going to have a move of God. God bless you in Jesus' name.